countryside is on display. Pack up your caravans. We'll travel down our great highway to our white sun-blessed land. The Leyland's Australia, great Aussie holidays. Australia, let the Leylands show you the way. The Leylands will show you Australia. Let the Leylands show you the way.
With the monsoon rain set in for the next 3 months, we've decided to head south from Darwin to Central Australia. We're following the Stuart Highway, which runs through the heart of the Northern Territory.
It took just 2 days to reach this marvellous outback campsite just north of Tennant Creek.
From here, our odyssey resumes.
Along the way, we'll visit Tennant Creek, Australia's last gold rush town.
Join the locals for the Tennant Creek Cup.
Travel through the spectacular Davenport Ranges.
We'll visit the Devil's Marbles.
Discover the stunning beauty of Central Australia.
Take a camel ride down the Todd River in Alice Springs.
Make our own fresh bread, both in the van and in the bush.
We'll come face to face with the animals here at the Alice Springs Desert Park.
Before we left Darwin, Laraine and I decided to make a few changes to our rig. We got rid of our faithful 13-year-old truck and slide-on camper in favour of this. This is an F250 four-wheel drive. It's much stronger and bigger than the old one. We also have a much bigger caravan.
The new truck has a big 7.3-litre V8 diesel engine, extra room in the cabin for our cameras and other bits, and of course, the back is cavernous, carrying all of our camping gear. We can access a camp refrigerator through these side-opening windows. And from the rear, we can readily remove items, such as this 3,000-watt generator. Even in remote locations like this, we can run the entire camp on the generator. We decided on a larger caravan so we can use it as our home as well as a mobile studio to edit our television programs. We'll give you a detailed look at the caravan later. The Stuart Highway slices through some of the world's most inhospitable and arid landscapes. It would be an unimaginable engineering marvel to John McDougall Stuart, who battled hardship and unknown terrain to become one of Australia's greatest explorers. He undertook over 7 expeditions within South Australia before successfully finding a practical route from Adelaide in the south to Van Diemen's Gulf in the north in 1862. He'd reached the sea near the present-day site of Darwin. Along the way, he reached a spot halfway between south and north and halfway between the east and west coasts. He declared it the geographical centre of the country. He raised the Union Jack on a nearby hill, which now bears the name of Central Mount Stuart. Fanciful artist's sketch of the day attempts to show the rugged conditions in the steamy tropics as Stuart's party battled to reach the sea in the north. His dogged determination and persistent, carefully considered decisions rightfully earned him the adoration of his backers in Adelaide. He never lost a man on any of his expeditions and opened the route for the Overland Telegraph Line, which was later built along his exploration route. To enable the telegraph line to function, a series of repeater telegraph stations were constructed at not more than 500 kilometre intervals. These were usually elaborate stone buildings which housed the telegraph operators, a linesman to maintain the line, and a station master. Just north of Tennant Creek, the surviving structures of the old telegraph station whistle with the whispering desert wind and echo with the tapping Morse keys of a bygone era. These buildings just off the side of the highway are easily reached by motorists and serve as a reminder that this harsh land was tamed just over 100 years ago. The few remaining poles no longer support the single wire which carried vital messages from England to Australia. Constructing the overland telegraph line was an amazing feat of human endeavour and took place just 10 years after Stuart first came this way. Most of the equipment and supplies were hauled across the desert by camel. The telegraph operators manned their stations day and night, and the outpost colonies down under somehow seemed closer than a 20,000 kilometres to London. Pastoralists followed the route of the telegraph line and took up grazing land. Then came the gold rushes. The last gold rush took place in the 1930s at Tennant Creek. Even then it was a wild, trackless journey across from Queensland. Intrepid would-be prospectors took old trucks and cars across virgin country. Jack Ford, still resident in Tennant Creek today, remembers how he, as a boy, crossed the desert in his father's jalopy to reach the gold fields.
Yeah, it was 1933, in the middle of the Depression, and my father was working with an old truck around Mount Isa, and he heard the story about gold being found in Tennant Creek, gold rush. So he packed us all up, headed us across to Barkly, and there was no roads across then. The only road was out as far as Camel Wheel. We had to look for this telephone, a bit of wire in the scrub, you know. It was amazing how we found it, but we seen the poles. And we yak-eyed and sang out to him, and he pulled up. Right, this was the overland telegraph line. And there was a bit of a track going in and out the lines, you know, where the linesman. So as it turned out, he hit it about 23 miles north of Tennant Creek. And to this day, I don't know how he knew to turn left. You just hit this line, you don't know whether Tennant's that side. And so he turned left and he went down. We came down to the Overland Telegraph Station out here that was there in the early days when they built the line. And we stayed there for a couple of days. My father used to walk out every day with his little pick and his hammer and bringing back stuff. And he never found anything. So he went out there and built the bow shed and the tent. And that's all we had, and a few sheets of iron. And there wasn't many on the field then. There was probably only about 20 or 30 people, but they were coming from everywhere, every day. In a nutshell, the town started to take off then. People had gold, you know.
With the gold came wealth, and Tennant Creek rapidly grew. Today, it still produces gold. As soon as we arrive in town, we visit a high hill overlooking town, which once rumbled with a gold-crushing battery. Here, visitors can put on safety helmets, ear mufflers, and experience life as a gold miner in a simulated underground mine.
You can see it's got a split on it. It gets tighter and tighter and tighter, and this is what holds it up there.
The demonstration is realistic, even down to the noise levels of the drill.
Thank you.
On the surface, the old battery is still in working order and is operated every day as a demonstration for visitors. This huge 8-stamp battery has been outmoded with more modern methods of extraction.
We happen to be in town for the annual Tennant Creek Cup, which is a $17,500 horse race and a great excuse for locals to gather and socialise. In spite of the carnival atmosphere of the occasion, we are assured the coveted Tennant Creek Cup is what it's all about. And of course, the thrill of picking the winner.
My team in the 1999 Tennant Creek City UB Cup, and Wayne Lawford was one of the first to get going quickly with him. The Stars and Jay Foss Delwyn looking for the lead as well. They turn the corner in the cup, and on the first position of the Tennant Creek Cup with 100 left to run, and a lot of thought wins it.
The owner and jockey travelled 700 kilometres from Alice Springs to claim the official trophy. And afterwards, an unofficial game of two-up wraps the day for some of the locals.
We decide to wrap our day with a meal of kangaroo, emu and camel steaks at the local hotel.
Well, Robert and Dad do. Mum and I stick with beef.
Show you the way.
We leave our caravans in the caravan park in Tennant Creek and set off on a three-day camping excursion in the two four-wheel drive vehicles. We'll travel a 560-kilometre circuit trip through the rugged Davenport Ranges, where four-wheel drive high-clearance vehicles are essential.
Just 90 kilometres south of Tennant Creek, we say goodbye to the bitumen road and start to eat dust. The first part of the gravel road is well graded, but very dusty.
Karundai Station is our first major stop. The owners of this sprawling cattle station have recently opened up some of their property to travellers. For a small fee, we're issued with a set of self-driving directions and plenty of outback cheer. The tracks are basic, and for some reason, I have been elected as chief gate opener for the dozens of gates scattered along the 140-kilometre circuit trip. Always leave the gates as you find them. The graziers control their cattle with the fences, and sometimes that means an open gate will provide access to water or feed.
An hour's drive from the homestead brings us to the site of a now abandoned attempt to tame this harsh country. The rusting relics of someone's past hopes lay scattered in the dust and blazing sun. It's late afternoon by the time we leave Karundi property, and as we're heading for a campsite on the Whistle Duck Creek where there's a ban on gathering firewood, we collect plenty on the way.
In the cool morning air after a good night's camp, we appreciate the fire and a hearty breakfast before setting off to explore the surrounding ranges.
Do you call yourself a cook?
Nah. Oh yeah, cook, not a chef.
Everyone makes ready for the new day. Carmen and the birds.
Well, the girl's got to look her best, even in the bush.
I agree, Carmen. In spite of the severe drought conditions, some of the deep water holes at the base of the nearby Ruppee Ranges have not dried up.
Mal and I decide to climb to the summit of the 200 metre ridge, about 2 kilometres from our camp. From here we can see about 60 kilometres of the featureless expanse of the country ahead of us. Wild donkeys roam the Davenport Ranges, having built up into sizeable herds from those let loose by early settlers and transport teamsters over 100 years ago. Epinara Homestead is a handy refuelling stop about halfway along our circuit drive.
For our second night in the Davenport Ranges, we head into a strictly four-wheel drive section of track to a remote spot which was once an outpost for the law. Old Police Station Waterhole is a permanent body of water in the bed of the Frew River and a perfect place to camp.
With an abundance of water, it's also a chance to wash away the dust of 2 days' travel.
Morning gives birth to a glorious day in the outback and a chance to investigate the campsite in daylight. The main point of interest here is on the opposite bank of the Frew River, where the remains of the old police station and lockup lay decaying in the forgotten memories of those who once lived in this lonely, desolate part of the world.
The old police station was built here around about the end of the First World War, because at that time, Aborigines roaming around the area were still pretty wild. In fact, they were spearing the odd traveller and spearing some cattle. It was decided to bring the law to this part of the country. And because this was the only permanent waterhole in the area, this is where they decided to build the police station. And today, of course, it's completely abandoned. If these crumbling ruins could speak, what tales would they tell? We return to Tennant Creek to collect our caravans.
Let the Leylands show you the way.
South of Tennant Creek, a branch of the Stuart Highway diverts into a remarkable landscape strewn with massive red boulders. Known as the Devil's Marbles, this geological oddity draws travellers like a magnet. The Devil's Marbles, it's a great name for this pile of boulders laying out here in this desolate desert region. It tends to suggest that these boulders were in fact placed on the ground by some geological event, you know, like a big bag of marbles, but in fact it's exactly the opposite. This was the rock which has been eroded away. In fact, the process is still continuing today. Water works its way between small cracks, eventually that wears its way itself into the rock. You see this piece here, this slab is moving away from the rock. There's another slice on this side of this rock here. Eventually that process will continue all the way underneath until you have these rather peculiar ones that look like they're balanced very delicately.
Sunset is a great time to view the glowing boulders, but so is sunrise. So we decide to camp overnight to await the dawn. The Devil's Marbles are contained within a reserve which has toilet facilities and room for plenty of caravanners and travellers. Most rise early to catch nature's light show. One colourful Aboriginal legend attributes the marbles to the eggs of the mythical rainbow serpent from the Dreamtime.
Our odyssey through the outback takes us closer to the heart of our country. Stretches of endless bitumen allow our small convoy of vehicles to devour the vast emptiness with ease. How different it was for explorer Stuart and those who forged this road in his footsteps.
We take a break from the monotonous rumble of the engine to pause a moment at the monument to John McDougall Stuart. Appropriately, it is located just off the highway, quite near central Mount Stuart. Reaching this spot was an achievement of momentous satisfaction to the Scottish explorer.
Ironically, this barren land, which inflicted such hardship on Stuart, has proven to be rich and arable. As if in deference to the arid surroundings, subterranean water and fertile soil are now producing bumper crops of citrus and mangoes. And the mangoes in turn have been turned into a table wine here and sold as mango mist. The pioneering settlers would be amazed.
When this area first opened up to travellers, horses, camels and bullocks were used as a means of transport. They could only travel about 30 miles each day because they needed water. A series of wells were sunk along what is now known as the Stuart Highway. This well is one of the few that survived today.
Ned Ryan completed it in 1889 and is one of many which he sunk in the Northern Territory. The well resulted in Glen Maggie Homestead being built close by. For years it operated as a telegraph station, as well as the base of a grazing enterprise which proved to be a lonely, unwinnable struggle.
This spot on the Todd River is usually a pond of reliable water. It's only in times of drought like this that it dries up. When the first pioneers come this way constructing the overland telegraph line between Adelaide and Darwin, they thought it was a spring. Mr. Charles Todd, the telegraphic superintendent, was the man charged with the huge responsibility of constructing that vital link with the rest of the world. This spot was named after his wife, Alice. Alice Springs, the waterhole, was where they decided to build a telegraph station. And it's still here on the banks of the river. These beautifully restored buildings are on the outskirts of the town of Alice Springs. The telegraph station today plays host to thousands of tourists who visit Central Australia. It houses a museum depicting the history of the overland telegraph story.
Time seems to move slowly here, and the scones, cooked in the wood-fired oven, keep some old traditions alive.
to the delight of visitors.
A sense of the past lives on in the stables and the nearby blacksmith's shop, where a skilled artisan demonstrates his ancient art every day.
One very good camp peg for you.
Can't get much fresher than that.
From those small beginnings, when just 20 or so souls lived in an isolated outpost, the modern town of Alice Springs has grown. The present day population is 27,000. Anzac Hill, overlooking the town, is a gathering point for visitors at sunset. For many, it is the culmination of a lifelong ambition. There is no other town like Alice.
Let the Leylands show you the way.
Alice Springs, situated in the centre of Australia, draws visitors from all over the country. They come here from all states. During the week, the modern mall in Todd Street is almost European. But every second Sunday, that great Aussie tradition, the markets, transforms it dramatically. Dad buys a belt, and Robert, well, now, where would we hang that in the caravan?
Okay, just looking. He's trying to rip me off anyway.
Choosing a good caravan park is a critical part of getting the most out of travelling. Where there's a choice, we always pick a park which caters for tourists. Many parks, like this, are advertised as tourist parks, and it's here with first-class clean facilities that we'll base ourselves for the next few weeks so we can investigate the surrounding country.
Some things never change, you still have to do your washing.
For Mal, the chores mean time to empty the cassette toilet from the van.
Actually, it's not such a bad job, especially when proper facilities are provided. The environmentally friendly chemicals used in the cassette eliminate any odours and commence breakdown of the waste until it's emptied.
At this particular tourist park, the owner puts on free pancakes every Sunday morning for breakfast, and it sure is popular, to the tune of over 700 pancakes in an hour.
Everyone, no matter how old, gets a name tag. The long queue provides a good opportunity to meet other travellers.
We do it every Sunday, every day, every Sunday of the year.
Occasions like this provide a good chance to mingle and make new friends. Some are just discovering the caravan lifestyle, like Brian.
Last year we drove all the way to Cairns, 7,600 k's, and we stayed in nothing but motels, and you get up in the morning, you jump in your car and move to the next town. But this place, you don't get up in the morning and leave, you get up and yap with everybody in the park, swap addresses, and 9 times out of 10 when you get to the next caravan park, the same people are there. And it's just a family friendship way all the way around.
You meet them down and up and down the road as you're travelling each
exactly,
day.
Exactly, yeah. Well, exactly. No, it's the only way to go.
Yeah, real good. It's good.
Now seems like a good time to take a detailed look at our new van. This is a Jayco 20-foot caravan built to a standard design with some modifications to suit our special needs. The chassis is galvanised and rugged with a conventional load-sharing tandem axle setup.
Now the axle is underslung to give us additional clearance, and we have 8-ply tyres for the stony country.
We have 2 water tanks working independently of each other.
Although they're protected from stone damage, an accident could still happen and we could lose the water, at least from one tank. This way, at least we're left with the other tank, and nobody should travel the outback without plenty of water.
The awning on the side of the caravan is just about an essential item these days. It provides you with the all-important shade to protect you from the sun. The spare wheel is carried on the rear bumper. The bumper's quite strong and could, in fact, support a bicycle carrier. The door is at the rear of the van. Let's take a look inside. The back end of our van here is, in fact, a little office. In this corner here, we have a computer. This allows us to write the scripts for our programs and also to do some of the editing on it. We also have a sound system in here for monitoring our sound. And also here, we have an edit system. This is the heart of the whole business. Here, we can preview all of the tapes that we take every day, and we can edit them up. This is where we really produce Leyland's Australia, right here in the caravan.
And this door leads to the bathroom, which has a flushing toilet, a drop-down hand basin and a shower. A built-in collapsible TV antenna can be raised, lowered or rotated from inside the van. We have a spacious lounge along one side and a nice roomy kitchen on the other. This is equipped with a four-burner stove, a griller and an oven. I wouldn't be without an oven. The refrigerator is also a large one. Our main water tank has a pressure pump and gas hot water system. This hand pump draws from the second tank and is for drinking water only. The pantry is quite large with two doors. The windows are hopper style, providing good ventilation. A two-door hanging wardrobe is right next to the bed. To give ourselves a little bit more living space, we've run the bed across the van. It's a little bit more difficult to make than an island bed, but it has made the van a metre shorter. Show you the way.
Central Australia was settled with the aid of the camel, so no visit to Alice Springs is complete without a camel ride. Robert and I decide to take a ride down the dry course of the Todd River. Our swinging jaunt begins near town at a date farm and will end at the camel farm about an hour's ride away. There, our tour will conclude with an evening meal.
I'll let him up there.
No.
Alright, first story, ground floor, please.
Okay.
How do you feel, Carmen?
Oh, a little sore.
We quickly forget our aches when the food appears. This is a bit more elaborate than our daily bread. Speaking of bread when travelling, Mum has some ideas of her own on that subject.
I prefer to make my own. When we're in a caravan, I use a robust bread maker like this. This one travels well and produces a good-sized loaf. I simply place the ingredients in, turn it on and forget it for a few hours. That's a bit difficult when the aroma starts wafting through the van. I didn't have a bread maker for 27 years of travelling, but that didn't stop us from having our bread. A simple form of upmarket damper, which is almost as good as conventional bread, is beer bread. This is a recipe I've been using for years. It's fast, simple, and delicious. Into a bowl, place 3 cups of self-raising flour. Add 2 heaped tablespoons of powdered milk, some salt, and the magic ingredient, beer. You add the beer gradually, and you're working the dough until it's sticky to the touch. So don't add all the beer at once, just work it in as you're going. Mix it to a nice sticky consistency. And if there's any beer left over, there's always some way of getting rid of it. Just give it a slight knead, just enough to smooth it out a little bit. And then just pop it into your prepared bowl. It's been floured. You bake it in a very hot oven and you leave it in there for about 40 minutes. When we go camping, I use exactly the same technique, but cover the cake tin with a lid. Or I use a camp oven. I bury it in the coals of a fire, cover it with sand and wait for about 40 minutes. It's more difficult to control the heat with a wood fire, but this soon comes with practice. It works best in sand. The results are great. Yep, that's cooked.
You can cut it in my van.
You can cut it in my van too.
We can stop at mine on the way past.
And we'll stop at mine on the way past too.
Our van's closer.
You've got to be quick, they nicked the bread already. I cooked it.
What happened to our bread?
I cooked it, Carmen's taken.
And I'm eating it.
This one is ready now too. There it is, fresh, delicious bread, all with the help of a can of beer. By the way, it doesn't taste of beer and all the alcohol has disappeared.
The region around Alice Springs has been referred to as the Red Centre, an apt description for this unique landscape of rugged rocks and dazzling red earth. We set off into the blue and purple hues of the McDonnell Ranges west of Alice Springs. A sealed road skirts the ranges, then turns to gravel, swinging south to return via Palm Valley. A round trip of 450 kilometres in 3 days. First stop, Simpson's Gap. This and other gaps in the range present a stark beauty which beckons artists, photographers and sightseers alike.
A perfect sealed road links several grandiose gorges, gaps and rock holes. Just a little further west is Stanley Chasm. It's reached by a short walk which follows a dry creek bed. By moving quietly and keeping our eyes skinned, we suddenly find ourselves face to face with a black-footed rock wallaby.
These endearing creatures are common in the ranges, and although normally timid, this one is so intent on eating the contents of a cycad tree nut, we can approach quite close. The discarded husks are scattered everywhere around the palm-like cycad trees. The narrow cleft of Stanley Chasm is best seen around midday, when it's bathed with a shaft of sunlight for just 20 minutes.
The stark, rugged folds of the McDonnell Ranges, which parade alongside the highway, tempt travellers to stop with dozens of beauty spots. Our first day in the West McDonnell Ranges is quickly coming to an end. But we do manage time to visit Serpentine Gorge before pressing on at dusk to reach the end of the sealed road. Glen Helen Homestead, nestled at the base of the ranges, now operates as a tourist resort and is our planned overnight stop.
Welcome to Glen Helen Resort, guys. You have a good trip.
We time our arrival just in time for dinner, which works out well since today is Robert's birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Robert. Happy birthday to you.
Hip hip.
Hooray!
Hip.
Hooray!
Hip. Hooray!
Show you the way.
Red sandstone cliffs line the southern bank of the Fink River at Glen Helen Resort. In the light of early morning, we get our first chance to see the impressive gap in the ranges, which was carved by this ancient river, reputed to be the oldest in the world. These ancient cliffs have been towering over Glen Helen Gorge almost since time began. By comparison, the old homestead and even its historic meat house are relatively new. This amazing old meat house on the banks of the Fink River here is a great example of a meat house. These were used to hang up the meat from the slaughtered beasts. This particular one has a fireplace over here, and they obviously use that for smoking the meat to make beef jerky.
On our second day in the McDonald's, we visit possibly the most impressive gorge of them all. Almaston. A ranger station provides complete visitor information and a chance for an encounter with a wild but fearless dingo, which has made the camping grounds home. From here we tackle a serpentine circular walking trail around the steep sides of a breathtaking gorge. Although steep in places, a well-made safety chain and pathway make it easy.
We descend to the river level and rest in the cool shade of the canyon.
valley beyond beckons, but we must move on, now on gravel roads.
Redbank Gorge requires a little more energy, so we top up our tummies before tackling the track which leads about 1 kilometre up the gorge. The armed-formed track follows a sandy riverbed. It sure tests the leg muscles, and in places, our sense of balance. Well, at least my sense of balance.
Yeah, my knee landed right on the edge of that rock.
Did you drop it?
Anyone else want a drink?
Did you go over?
Yeah, I'll have a drink.
I don't know what happened. It just happened really fast.
Luckily, Carmen only has a minor sprain. So we push on to the incredible red cliffs of the gorge and waterhole. Over 100 kilometres of dust and corrugations take us through an impressive grove of desert oaks to Hermansburg.
Hermansburg Aboriginal community began when a group of Lutheran missionaries came here in 1877 to bring Christianity to the Arunte people. They established an outpost of civilization in the wilderness, constructing impressive stone buildings. Many of the desert people enthusiastically adopted the new religion and packed the church for worship every Sunday. One of those worshippers was baptized Albert. His tribal name, Namitijira, means flying ant. Albert Namitijira not only loved his tribal lands of the McDonnell Ranges, but also developed the skill to capture their beauty with watercolors. His famous talents earned him a special place in the world of art. His story is proudly told to all who visit the old mission today.
One of the jobs Albert did in the mission days was blacksmithing. No matter what Albert did, it had to be 100% correct, even making a horseshoe. If he wasn't satisfied with it when it came to time to use it, he'd melt it down and reforge it. Near enough was never good enough. The building we're going to, this one, was the manse where the pastors used to live with their families. And where you got your tickets there, that was the house that was built for the mission superintendent. The church and the house are 102 years old this year. He never had any formal training as an artist whatsoever. And the 8 weeks that he was given were given to him by a man called Rex Batterby. And Batterby had such a high regard for Albert, he actually wrote in his diary, "Albert has learnt more in the 8 weeks than my students in Victoria have ever done in 3 years."
The old stone building now houses a collection of not only Albert Namitijira's work, but the works of the other 30 or so Arunte artists who continued in his style of watercolours. All of the art reflects the stark, colourful country of the region we call the Red Centre.
Modern artists of a different kind carry on the tradition with hand-painted silk and pottery, some of which is for sale at Hermansburg. Judith Punkata is one of several women who work at Hermansburg producing their outstanding pottery. The larger pieces sell for thousands of dollars to a willing market in the cities.
Hand-painted silk, also produced at Hermansburg, is slow, deliberate work which suits Frida Campbell. Each piece is unique.
From Hermansburg we head south on a four-wheel drive track to the incredible Palm Valley, where Mal, although not usually excitable by scenery, just loves the landscape for its sheer photogenic splendour.
We tackle the last 5 rough kilometres in the fading light of afternoon, just in time to catch some memorable images. These massive cycads and the even more rare red cabbage palms are like living fossils from an ancient tropical past in this ancient, timeless land. In the fading light of sunset, we return to Alice Springs, only to discover that one of the tyres on Robert's car has deflated overnight.
There you go.
I didn't think something so small could do so much damage.
This is just cleaning the hole up. Ready for the plug to go in.
Just 10 minutes drive from the Alice is one of the Northern Territory's truly greatest attractions, the Alice Springs Desert Park. Here plants and animals are presented together in their natural habitats. Visitors have a chance to see up close animals behaving naturally in their various desert environments. In the desert rivers section, it is not only what we can see on the surface of the ponds, but the life underwater too, which is on display. Great care has been taken to ensure that the plant life is a true collection of that which exists only in unspoilt wilderness regions, often inaccessible to many travellers, and the animals love it.
Over 100 animal species live in the park, many of which are nocturnal and are only active at night. With simulated moonlight turned on during the daytime, we can observe these cute creatures of the night as they go about their food foraging, behind glass, undisturbed by our presence. Another feature of the park are the guide talks, where we can learn all about Aboriginal bush tucker.
Okay, we've got some important survival foods here for Aboriginal people. This is the desert Flinders grass from this region. It's a grass seed. This is a seed from the acacia tree, from the ironwood tree. It's ground into a flower. And we've got another flower here, which is the flower from the dogwood. And here is the seed from the actual dogwood tree.
And that little fine seed there, what do they do with that?
What does the work for the Aboriginal women is a little ant. And he's a friend of the grass. The ant lives amongst the grass. The ant collects up the grass seed, takes it down to its chamber, nibbles off this little appendage, and then when it eats that off, it carries the seed back to the surface and dumps it in piles. And so all the women have to do is come along and scoop up the piles.
There is no doubt that our majestic birds of prey are the real stars of the park. Every day at the specially constructed outdoor theatre, free-flying birds gather before an appreciative audience. Australia's largest bird of prey, the wedge-tailed eagle. Most remarkable of all is this black-breasted buzzard. Its natural food includes the eggs of other birds, and one of its favourite eggs are the huge, hard-shelled eggs of the emu. In a truly astounding example of animal behaviour, these birds have learned to split the tough shell by throwing a stone at it until it cracks. Once a small hole appears, it's no problem at all to rip it open with that powerful beak and talons. The black-breasted buzzard, unique in the world, and another of Australia's greatest natural wonders. Next on Leyland's Australia, our caravanning odyssey continues. In a few minutes, a strip of bark from the paper bark tree is converted to a convenient drinking vessel. This is a rare chance for most people to see a wild croc this close. All eventually become encased within the beautifully shaped limestone formations known as tufa.
The life-giving water attracts all forms of life, including a large variety of birds.
1 minute it's a paradise for birds, the next a mirror adrift with golden icebergs. Next on Leyland's Australia.
Our countryside is on display. Pack up your car.
For great travel information, why not collect Leyland's Australia, the magazine? A new one will be in your newsagents every 3 months. If you like our TV shows, you'll love the magazine.
Leyland's Australia, great Aussie holidays. Australia, let the Leylands show you the way. The Leylands will show you Australia. Let the Leylands show you the way.